to work with you.
Praise Jesus.
So go in there and register for BS very fast and make a screenshot, post on your status, and get that friend that is still doubting. Tell you, my friend, these things are possible. You know, register very fast and share with them the link. Praise Jesus. We're running out of time. We are about to start our BS, and we want you to register. We not start it without you. Praise Jesus. So hurry up and use. Click on our link, www.uaabcu.org. Register as a member. If you have there's something you find there in the corner, click on it, and you'll find online registration. So you'll find Bible study registration. When I see you, some of us, yes. Is the university beautiful? All that happens in the university. Now you're welcome for it. We're in the right place. Thank you very much. I'm Austin Oshie. God bless you.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You can see me kindly over to me. Yes, you look wonderful from up here. My name is Sylvia Nyamwea, a fourth year student in the School of Education, taking education arts, combination of Kiswahili and religion, serving as the CU secretary. Let us pray for the offerings. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity once again to be in the sanctuary, Lord, King of glory. Even as we give our offerings, we pray that may you receive and may you bless it. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
For them giving in cash, the baskets will be going round. And for them giving in soft copy, I'm going to read out the number 0729896562. 0729896562. Should I repeat again? 0729896562. One last time. 0729896562. Yes. Let's take this opportunity to welcome any visitors in our Midist associates. Yes. Any visitors in our Midist? We thank God. The following are our announcements from the discipleship docket. I would like to inform us about Bible study for this semester. We are encouraged to register online in the links that are being sent in our WhatsApp groups. Kindly let us adhere to what the board chair has told us. Bible study is for us and it is compulsory for everyone. Yes, so kindly let us register. And for those who are not yet members, also do so, so that you can be able to register online for the Bible study. Yes, I would also like to inform us about the discipleship classes. I believe the discipleship leader made it clear during the orientation. Yes, so we'll be having Mizizi and Best P. We are asked to register for the same. The forms will be going round, I believe, in the Sunday service. Yes, first years, Mizizi is for us. Let's register and be partakers of it. Yes, and continuing students, best fees here. Yes, those who have done Fishers, now it's time to do Best Fee. Yes, kindly register and be there. Yes, we'd also like to thank all the continuing students for the good work that you're doing in the orientation and for giving yourself for this week to help our first years settle in properly. God bless you so much. Let us clap for the continuing students. Yes, from the missions docket, we'll be having follow-up to Mount Elgon this month of October. Yes, those willing to go, kindly register. with the missions coordinator, that is Edwin Kipto. Also, prayers for the least reached people group will be happening every Monday at the bush from 5 p.m. First years, don't worry. On Sunday, you'll be shown where the bush is. Yes. Also, from the missions docket, Chisegem prayers will be there on Saturday, that is the 2nd of October at 2 p.m. Therefore, those who will be going to Chisegem, you are required to meet immediately after scripture engagement at 8:05 for a common departure. From the prayer docket, we are reminded of SPM training that is going to be there tomorrow as from 8 a.m. So prayer secretaries, you are urged to meet at Gate A for a common departure. On the same note, we are also reminded for SPM prayer afternoon that will be happening on 10th of October at the Deliverance Church. We are all encouraged to attend. Yes, then there is Commission 21. Praise God. Praise God.
Amen.
How many of you have heard about Commission 21? May I show of hands? Yes, I want to believe those who have heard about Commission have also registered for the same. How many have registered for Commission 21 by show of hands also? The hands are reducing, I don't know why. Yes, so Commission Conference is happening this year. It's going to be happening virtually from the 30th of October to the 14th of November. The theme for the conference is a gospel transforming a dynamic world. The registration for the conference is still ongoing. Registration is through the link conferences.focuskenya.org. The cost is only 300 shillings. Only 300 shillings. It used to be 5,000. Now it is 300 shillings. Please let's register for the commission. In case you're having difficulty with the registration, see any committee member, the commission committee member, or the STEM staff so that they can help you with the registration. Kindly, yes, let's register for commission. It is here for us. There are going to be very many sessions, plenary sessions, the expositions. So don't miss. Please register for commission. It is only 300 shillings. Yes, we'd also like to emphasize on scripture engagement that is beginning today and will continue tomorrow. We are all encouraged to attend. Yes, we will be joined by students from the other campuses from within Eldoret, the North Rift region, that is. And we'll be having speakers like Pastor Albert Nandi on the topic Doctrine of Sin and on the topic of Prosperity Gospel, the Biblical Response by Ruben Kigame. Please, you don't want to miss this. Don't miss this. It's an opportunity that only comes once. So grab it with all your might. Yes, so be there. Yes, with refreshment will also be served. So keep on searching the uncle. Yes, upcoming events, we'll be having theme exposition this Sunday. Yes, so be here as we expose the theme for this new semester, new spiritual year, na tutakuwa kubarikiwa. There is someone who left their book, Edmond Chesang, it's PSY 311. You are just Nikita Gumpia, please kindly see me after the service and pick your book. Have a blessed evening and a blessed night ahead. Thank you.
Wow.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You can wave on to me. Wow. It's nice to be in the house of the Lord. And I want to welcome us all to today's fellowship. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, and welcome so much. Feel and feel of Jesus. Yes, we, for them who are watching us from their places, we also welcome them in this service. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, this service is live. It's being aired. There are other members who could not make it, especially for tonight's fellowship. And I'm also here to usher us into Scripture Engagement Forum. Yes, and it has just begun, and it will continue tomorrow from 8 a.m. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, we will be using NS2 and the NS ground. We have some tents that we have organized. We could not use this venue again because of the events that normally happen here, but you will be catered for. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, when you don't secure maybe a seat in the hall, please don't be offended. Just bear with us. We'll work out the PA system and you'll be able to hear the gospel very well, even from outside. And we bless the Lord for that. I want to share scripture, the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. I will start from 44b to 49. Bible says, if there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. For it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. That is in Genesis 2:7. And the last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural. And after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth, and the second man of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of earthly man, so shall we bear the image of heavenly man. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, the scripture reminds us of, as there is a natural body, we also have a spiritual body. And the first Adam was a living being. And the last Adam is a life-giving spirit. Praise the name of the Lord. And that's our Lord Jesus Christ. And we bless the Lord because of that. I want to acknowledge the presence of AC around. AC is advisory committee. So if there is advisory committee around, feel welcome. And I just want you to maybe join me here and introduce yourself to first years. Yes. Any AC around? Wow. You can appreciate our mom.
But I thank God. I want to thank God for the privilege of serving
that I love the Lord Jesus. And I want to encourage all of us. God has a reason why you are here today. Please don't miss tomorrow's session. You cannot afford to have servants of God coming and you find even this evening. I really thank God for his servant today. But we love you. Young people, hold on to God. There is no other way. Thank you, Chair, and be blessed. I serve as the patron for a while, and I thank God for everything. Thank you.
We're going to have a chef come on. Yeah. Thank you so much, Mom. She's Dr. Victoria Chichi, and she's our patron. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, and we love her so much. Yes, she's a mom to us, a friend, an advisor, and all that. A co-worker, see. Praise the name of the Lord. Yes, thank you so much for your support. Yes, and as she have just said, you should not miss a session. And I want to welcome us all even to tomorrow's sessions. I want to also acknowledge Focus staff. They just join here. They say hi to us before we hear the word. You can appreciate them as they come. I have seen several focus stars around. I said, maybe you agreed this one to represent you. Yeah, okay.
My name is Peter Kasimiti. I am not new to you, except for the first years, whom I think those who are there on Wednesday we interacted. I serve as a focus staff at the campus ministry facilitator for UOE Christian Union. This marks the beginning of a scripture engagement forum that we have an emphasis on some basic aspects of the Christian faith that we think they have been discussed before, and we'd just like to give an emphasis, or rather, a focus on what does the scripture say about that. Yeah, so I came along with my colleagues, wondering where they have gone, but there is one focus on who is around, and I'd like just him to come on stage and just to say hi, and then we will see, because time is not
Hey, what does it do, son?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
My name is Humphrey Walish. I'm born again. I love Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I'm so glad to be back here. This is second home for me. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We can appreciate it more. Yes, wow. This is how our state staff, Anto Malele, I have seen Iverton Kataka, regional coordinator, and we are glad for the ministry in focus. Pray the name of the Lord. Now, may I see first years in the house? First years, the show hall. You can appreciate them more. Yes. What can we tell our first years?
Welcome to the University of Federal Christian Union, where love is more than words.
Welcome to Christian
Welcome to University of Frederick Christian Union, where love is more than words. And we love you so much. I want us to hear from the Lord. Our topic today is Doctrine of Grace. Our speaker did his bachelor's degree in Moi, master's degree in Moi, PhD in economics also in Moi. And he is a pastor in Spiritual Pentecostal Fellowship and a member of Focus Associates. He's married to Lydia and blessed together with a daughter and a son. And his name is Dr. Humphrey Omondi. You can appreciate him as he joins here. You can appreciate him. Thank you so much. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this hour, or even as we sit at your feet. And we pray that you speak to us, may you correct us, rectify us, O Lord, and show us the way. In the name of Jesus we pray.
A bit faster, and that's why the speedometer is there, isn't it? So I want to bless God. I'm going to share with you a few things. You've been told I am a pastor at Siriko Pentecostal Fellowship, but I work in Karatina. And I bless God for opportunity to serve there. I'm part of the administration. That part I do when I have time, but I was actually sent there to deal with the students. So I deal with the students, I minister the word of God. When I get a little time, I go to the administrative office. And we thank God. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to share with you some few things. When I will be sharing, there are a few things I'm going to say. And as I say these things, you might get a few thoughts which do not look like they are things that you need to hear. But you really need to hear them. So I'm going to try as much as possible to keep within what you know and what you understand. Because there are some of these things which are controversial on things that you know will encourage people and will cause them to move in the things of God. I'm still getting my laptop set up. Sorry, I just arrived, so I needed to get it set up. It's coming. Karim. Very shortly it will be there. But we want to talk about grace. And this is one area that I've known, or even as we have shared with people, we've realized that there are many things that disturb, and there are many things that sometimes get to the hearts of men. And you will get that sometimes people say things or do things which you doubt. And if you ask them, normally the word that comes in is, we are operating under the grace of God. So we are not under the law, so don't judge me. I don't know if that is something that you have heard and is familiar to you. Because that to me is familiar. And many, many people actually deal with it. Hallelujah. So as we talk about grace, I want to introduce a few definitions, then I'll go to a few thoughts about the grace of God. Then we will go back and deal with the doctrine of grace. As I start this, I want to mention to you a few things that you can pick up as a background. One of the things I have learned over time, and my brother Everton, it's good you're here as you oversee this focus area. I have learned that university students and charismatic churches and Pentecostal churches love noise. Nasarakas. They love things that move towards yo, you know? You get what I'm talking about now? I'm about to ambition now. Come on, say yeah! When you finish the meeting, the yeas and the amens and all this, there's only one verse of the Bible. And the noise does not edify. What edifies is the word of God. So I want to bring us to a point where we understand the basis of the word and stay on the word. The word will liberate you. The noise won't. The noise is good, by the way. It's good to have a little noise. Even the wall of Jericho. Noise. Kunavini. Hello? But get the word. Somebody said that when you have a lot of noise of Pentecostalism without the word, you blow up. But again, there's an extreme where you are so the word and there's no Holy Ghost, you dry up. But when you have the word, then you have the noise, you grow up. And that's to the level we want to get to. So there is a discussion that was there in the medieval days where people used to argue about this thing called grace. Because there are some people who believe that for you to get to the grace of God, you had to work towards it. You had to persevere. You had to go through trouble. You had to beat your body. You had to bring yourself to the level where every day there's a dose of grace that adds up to you so that you come to the level where godliness can now be justified. So that you had to get that dose of grace to a level where God can come down and meet you. So that you have to work something. And there's sometimes that if you couldn't work, then you supplement your grace with somebody else's grace. John, if you knew somebody who was a man of God, who was so committed and was so good and had surplus grace, then you can get the top up of grace from this person to you. And that way, you can be justified. And that was something that some reformists refused. And they said it's not going to work. They had even brought it to the level where they say, you can actually come to a point that if you die and your grace level was not justifiable, we can pray for you, and those saints can pray, save or get justified if you had enough money. So that people would even buy a bit of grace for you to come to the level of justification. And that wasn't working. So they worked against it and they reformed. When the reformist agenda came, and some of these things even came when you were baptized, there was a belief. Some of this sounds strange now that you hear it. There was a belief that you could be baptized as a small baby. And when you're baptized as a small baby, they give you the first dose of grace. And you will be working towards increasing your dosage of grace so that by the fullness of time, grace would have increased to a level where your godliness is justifiable. And they refused this. And they said, we believe that you cannot merit justification by God. And they came up with an agenda. And one of these other people who came up with this is somebody called Calvin. And you would hear of Calvin, doctrines of grace. And they came from this because he rejected the idea that you must work your way out into grace. And their idea was that no, you are actually born again because the grace of God was illuminated to you to the extent that you had enough faith to touch that grace, and that's why you're justified. So you cannot walk your way and say, I'm going to possess and come to a level where I can get born again. There's a guy called Paul in the Bible. Paul says that if there's anybody who did things here, I was circumcised on the eighth day, born a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin, persecuting those guys, and I was zealous for this, but all those things I counted as done. And that's the level of saying that there is no way you can work your way to come to the justification of God. You can't get your salvation through your work. So this came out, and the reformists came with this idea of grace. And they say you can only be born again because the Holy Spirit convicts you. You, by faith, touches that which God has given. And this is how it works. The hand of God called mercy reaches down to you, and your hand that reaches back to God is called faith. So faith touches mercy. And what allows you to be positioned so that you can receive this mercy is called grace. I'm surprised at all our ladies. I don't know what happened to us as men. There's mercy and there's faith and there's grace. So I want you to understand from the beginning that you are not born again because you have walked your way out. It's because of something that you did not merit. Actually, the definition of grace, as we know it, is unmerited favor. Undeserved mercy. An earned interest from God. So you didn't work for it. It just came. I want to read some scripture. And I thank God I'm seeing people with books, notebooks and pens. I'm hoping the pens write and the notebooks have space. Romans 5:15 gives us about the gift. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of one person, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? I will just touch on some, you will write it, and then you will follow it up. So that brings in the idea of how that gift of grace overflowed to many. 1 Peter 5:12 says this, with the help of Silas, whom I regard as a faithful brother, I've written to you briefly, encouraging you and testifying that this is the true grace of God. Stand fast in it. Because if you notice, there are some people who letters were written to, and First Peter is such a church, or Peter was getting this epistle written, you will get a lot of things out of it, because there are some people who came up with a strange grace. And you understand it even nowadays, it is there. If you go to the book of Romans, which really demarcates a lot of things about grace, you will get there. Let me first finish a few of these and we'll get to them. Ephesians 2:12. And I love this part. Remember that you were at times you were separate from God, excluded from the citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenant of promise, without hope and without God in this world. That's where you started from. So there's no way you would have redeemed yourself if it was not by the grace. Actually, the Bible then goes and says, but God. So it is God who steps in here and brings in the idea that makes you get born again or get the grace of God. Three things you need to know about grace. Many of us know that it is a merited favor. Understand that it is something that you cannot earn and you do not deserve. That's grace. David deserved to die at one point on two counts, adultery and murder. But when he finally saw the gravity of his sin, he confessed and repented of it. God put away his sin. He deserved to die, but that penalty that was supposed to come to him was moved aside. Then that tells you that God bestowed upon David a favor he did not merit. And he earned it not because of what he did or who he was, but because of the grace of God that came in to show him this mercy. So the first thing you need to know is that you do not deserve it. Second thing you need to know about grace is that you need to know how much we need it. Without a savior, all men are like those say to be without hope and without God in this world, in Ephesians. And man cannot be his own savior. He cannot be saved by attending church services, eating Lord's Supper, or teaching Bible classes. If we help all the needy and baptize all the people we know, if we sang until our tongues reached our knees, it will not save. Because of all these things, after everybody has done all these things, none of them will merit you the shed blood of Jesus. Amen. I'm just laying a foundation. I'm about to start preaching. A third thing you need to know about grace is that you must accept the grace for it to work in you. It won't work until you accept it. Jesus died for all mankind. That's Hebrews 29. But only a few will be saved. That's Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Since he died for all, why are all not saved then? Because most will not accept the gift of salvation. Jesus says, go to the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. So what is grace in that extent? The word grace in English is translated as the word charis. It's not a shrub of charis like Kikuyu. Charis. C-H-A-R-I-S. It's actually defined in Strong's Concordance. Those of you who deal with Strong's exhaustive concordance. You know, we used to have somebody who would say, according to Strong's, you know, just like lawyers, they say, according to the black dictionary. There's a guy called Black. And he defines every word. Every time you hear of a petition, they say, according to Black's dictionary. Now, Strong's is one of those ones that is considered very, very strong. Yeah. He defines grace as a manner of acts or divine influence on the heart that has a revelation in the very aspect of life. It has different connotations, but as it is translated, you will see where it comes from. In 1 Corinthians 16, the word grace is translated into a word called benefit. So that it's a benefit that you get, but it's not necessarily something that you get because you deserve an unearned benefit. In 2 Corinthians 1:15, it is defined as the word pleasure. So that you're dealing with God bringing you into his grace or the pleasure of God. In various aspects, you will see grace being translated to bring in different meanings. I'll have to run, I've checked my time, so I'll jump a few of those things. God's grace to man is expressed in some of these following scriptures. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, it says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. So by the grace of God, should taste death. In this aspect, it means by the pleasure of God. So God allowed Jesus to go through death, and that was by his grace, his pleasure and enablement. Ephesians 2, when you read 4 and 5, verse 4, it says this, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherein he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, have quickened us together with Christ. By grace, you are saved. I thought I would hear an amen from somebody. Amen. Even a first year. Because some of you coming to campus is by grace. Having gone through the corona exams, it's by the grace of God. You know, around that time, if somebody sneezed in the exam room, pandemonium. But God, by his grace, did allow him to come. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 12. And for those of you who don't like a lot of scriptures being preached, you like excitement, you'll pardon me today. I want to dig you into the word. 2 Corinthians chapter number 1, verse 12 says this. For our rejoicing is this, the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we have had our conversation in this world and more abundantly to you one. By the grace of God. Meaning, by the enablement of God. From this scripture, then you pick a few things which I want to emphasize very quickly. Look at them. One, they tell us that by God's grace, Christ died for us. You are missing many places to say amen. Two, by God's grace, we are made alive or we are saved. Amen. Three, by God's grace, we live our lives in this world. And you see clearly from that understanding, there's a clear and accurate understanding of the word of God and the word grace and how it fits into that word that comes to you. So grace is something that is bestowed. There is no place here where you see grace meaning that man has to work. And I'm bringing this because these are some things that people argue out. And I want you to have a balance. By the way, let me tell you this. However distorted your understanding of the word grace or salvation does not disqualify what it means. So that if somebody taught you a different thing on grace as you believe it, does not stop the real meaning of grace from operating. Hallelujah. Because there are some people who have worked their way to salvation by working. When you tell them that salvation only comes through faith, when you believe in God by grace, they don't believe it because they can bribe everybody and think they can also bribe God. Do everything that looks like you're doing it and comes there. And these are some of the things. I want to set a background and then you will understand. Because there are a lot of things that happen when we deal with these things of grace. There are people also abuse grace. So I'll get there also. Faith begets grace. So that your faith is what now comes and builds up the grace that is open towards you. It's important to understand that. When you observe your duty to do God's will, that's an expression of faith. This in principle builds up your ability to enjoy God's grace. And this God's grace is bestowed upon God's people as a response to faith. And this is expressed as you read, especially the book of Romans. The book of Romans, you see Paul really struggling to explain the issue about grace. And you see where he came from. This is a passage. If you pick up from the book of Acts, if I allow you to walk through there quickly, you see the first chapter of the book of Acts. You see where Jesus is now living. And there are some guys who are desolate. They are feeling so bad that Jesus is going. You know the bread multiplier? Some of you don't understand that. Let me try another one. The fish multiplier. Okay, it worked. Hallelujah. Remember that guy who brought the dead? Brought them back from the dead. Remember the guy who put somebody's ear back after Peter had with his gerehere had cut somebody's ear? You see this Jesus as the one who walked on water. Remember that? Now, this is the same person that you are with who is about to go. And then he goes. And he dies. And as if that is not enough, you go to the grave and he's not there. You know, sometimes, like people come from places which I will not mention for security reasons. Even if somebody dies, you want to see the body. That's what one in a match. We have to see, and when we buy, if we can't see it, we put a banana and put it so at least we feel that we are buying something. So you go and in the grave is not even there. That leaves you desolate. Then when you are up there and wondering what will happen, an angel appears and says, "You guys, don't worry. The same way you see him going is the same way he will come back." And I don't know why people don't understand that. I don't know why some people think there's a Jehovah when you're in the UK. The same way he went, the same way we'll see him. And the Bible says there will be a trumpet sound and we shall. Those who are dead in Christ will wake up first. There's a pastor who says that describes some churches. There's some churches that will wake up first. Because they are dead in Christ. Anyhow, some of you will catch a joke later. Have you ever caught a joke at night and you wake up? So we are at chapter number one. And at that point, we see Jesus going up and these guys are left desolate. They do not know how they will continue. Because the person they used to depend on has left. But they are told, "Tarry ye. Just hold on. You wait here until you'll be endued with power. Then you shall be my witnesses to go and preach this gospel." It's a promise they are given. And I think that now gets them a bit comfortable. Somebody wondered what they were doing in the upper room. They were not very prayerful and waiting. I think there must have been a few mamas there. You know, when you have Kierere, Peter, and Doubtful Thomas, and all those people in such a meeting, you have them. So there's a bit of Kierere, but God dealt with them. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, we get into chapter 2. The Holy Ghost comes down. I want you to see how it is building up, and you see the grace of God flowing. So these guys come out, and the Holy Ghost comes upon them, and they are baptized in the Holy Ghost, and upon them they see things that look like cloven tongues of fire. They all speak with other tongues, and guys come and say, these guys are drunk. Other guys are in jail, and he says, they came and asked, what meaneth this? Hallelujah. In a sound come God, God in here. What meaneth this? Have you ever seen people who pray in King James? You know, Almighty God, thy will. they as you suppose. Kulewa begins my Lord, I can see with them asking you. It is a different one. That's why later they say, be drunk in the Holy Ghost. You know, I see some people when you lay hands on them, they actually get drunk. You know, people can understand. You know? There's a girl who put Holy Ghost in there, but she just laughed into town. And it's fine, it's very nice when you see their hand. Now the Holy Ghost has come upon them. They have now power. They are in tune with power. They think things are going to be working very well. They are seeing excitement coming. And you see now chapter 3 comes in. And they start now going to places and they see the miracles of God coming. You know, somebody is going to the temple, he has not even arrived in the temple. On his way to the temple, by the way, do you notice that Peter was going to pray? Hello? He was on his way to prayer, and he told this guy, such as I have. Some people must go from church when they're coming. It's when they can say, such as I have. Because when you're going, you have nothing. But him, he had it every time. And that's how you're supposed to be. You must have it even when you're going to church. Hallelujah. Amen. And they pray, and then chapter 4 comes. And you know, chapter 4 always comes. Because now, they are beaten up. They have been excited. They have seen God coming. And you are getting excited. That happens to you in salvation. You are in trouble and desolate. And then chapter 2 came to you. You saw a revelation. You came in and you got born again. And you were told, now the old has gone. You are now new. Things have changed. And you got excited. And then chapter 4 came. They are taken and beaten up. And when they are beaten up, I think some of us would have started by saying, after all I have done for you, oh God. But these guys came out excited that they were counted worthy to join into the suffering of Jesus Christ. Uh-huh. And you see, this is not something that you do out of your own natural strength. Uh-huh. This is what we are talking about, the grace of God. Amen. And that's why they are bringing it out. Listen, they have beaten up. I can imagine people asking each other, who will the big one be? Now we'll touch. Now we'll in it. Woo! Many people are saga! I am more worthy than you. They are beaten up. And you see what they say? They go back and go back to God. And they tell God to give them strength. And when they are standing there and they pray for this strength, the ground where they are is shaken. Read verse number 31. It is shaken and they are filled another time with the power of the Holy Ghost. So there's sometimes the grace will feel like it is running out. You had grace for prayer. You had grace for moving. And you feel like things are going. I think there's a place you turn back to God and tell God, fill me another time. And there's a new grace that comes to you. And the place where their heart is shaken. And after it has been shaken, they move out in power. Notice after they have been beaten and they are shaken, that's why now we go to chapter number 5 and we start getting people giving out. Because it says towards the end of that chapter that they started getting things. Those who had things were selling. And they sold to people, and people who did not have were also blessed through what these people are doing. In chapter 5, we find somebody called Ananias. You remember Ananias? And this is Ananias. Sapphira and Ananias, you know? So, by the way, can I say one small thing about them? And that's why you see how the grace of God manifests to different people differently. These guys saw people selling things. And because they saw people selling, there's something we call monkey see, monkey do. You see people tithing, you see people giving, you see people excited, and you also decide, I believe I'm a to value. It's not a conviction of God. No wonder when you go to sell it, it now becomes so expensive, you say, hey. Can I tell you something? We have learned this with my wife. Everything you point towards God and give it to God becomes expensive immediately. Even sleep. Have you ever told God from the morning, from 4, that went to yoga? But I know that doesn't happen here. In other less spiritual places, it happens. But here, I hear it doesn't happen. The call that now comes. Have you ever said you're going to tithe or you're going to pledge something for new instruments? And then suddenly it becomes expensive. We picked a certain place in our farm and decided we're going to plant carrots here. And we said, we're going to give God these carrots. I have never seen such big carrots. God has a way. They were so big we couldn't do anything. We had to pick them and took to our pastor. I said, yeah, pastor. I remember them. I have never seen such big carrots. You mark any place and say, I'm giving it to the Lord. See what happens. And they become so expensive. Things become... Dedicate them to God. See the grace of God multiply over them. And those of men of you who want to get married, please remember, one of the things I never allowed men to touch my kids before I touched them and presented them to God. Anazaliwa nikiwa hapo. And I say, no, we dedicate them to God. And say, Father, we thank you for this girl. And we dedicate her to you. This is yours all your life. And then we tell the nurses, now you can continue. All my kids. Some of you men, if you went there, you would go, whatever you mark for God becomes expensive. And this is what happened in chapter number 5. But go to chapter number 6. You know, after this guy fell down, you know, and one of the things I keep telling people, please walk with your wives. If he came with a wife, at least one of them would have survived. Now you leave your wife behind. You are right. She doesn't know if to lie or to say the truth. Hello. We go to chapter number 6. I'm still talking about the grace of God. Are we there? So we go to chapter number 6 and you see what happens now here. People start murmuring. Women start complaining that they're getting less than what they're supposed to do. I want you to see how the grace of God multiplies when you're born again. Look at how you're translating to this. They complain. He's not saying that because they belong to God, they will not be complaining. It will be there. There's some things which will not work out until they have to decide and say, why should we go and serve tables? Let us now dedicate some few people to serve tables as we continue with this prayer. And that's why Stephen and the rest come in. You see how Stephen comes in now. Are you seeing the trend? Stephen comes into the picture because some women complained about food. Men, you missed a place to say amen. Some women complained about food. And because they complained about food, there was an introduction of demons. And these deacons had to be laid hands on, and they were full. Notice what the Bible says. He was laid hands on, and he had received the power of the Holy Spirit. And he was anointed to serve tables. So that some of you, when you're called to be ushers, you think you are not called. Some of you, when you are doing small things, you think you need the power of the Holy Ghost. And this guy was anointed. And yet, with that anointing to serve tables, he still did miracles. You can imagine he's dividing food and laying hands on sick people. And the miracles that were not with his hands were major. So there is no place that God cannot anoint you to bring miracles. Even if you're the one collecting offering, there is an anointing. Even if you're the one doing miracles and you're cleaning the seats, there is a certain anointing. Hallelujah. So Stephen did these things, and as he went out there, there is a guy who had vowed that he's going to bring these guys to Jerusalem bound. And this guy was called Saul of Tarsus. And he came and he was breathing fire. And he took them and he stood out there. And as he stood, all the people who were stoning Stephen brought their clothes to him, because in those days you had to get one righteous person who will stand and say that my blood of this person will be upon my head. And it is upon his feet that they will bring their clothes. The people who go to stone somebody don't stone with their clothes. You remove that covering, bring it to the feet of the person who justifies and says, the blood of that person is upon me. And you must be a righteous person. That's why when the lady who came to Jesus, they brought to Jesus because she was caught in the act alone. And if I can pick her up, you remember that? She was the only one who was brought. When she was brought to Jesus and saying that she was caught in the act, Jesus asked that the first person who has no sin be the first one to stone. Because there must be somebody without sin who will start surety and say, the clothes are here. And such a person was Paul. And they brought it to the feet of Paul. And Paul received those clothes. And he commanded that this guy be stoned. When he was being stoned, you remember what he did? He looked up and he said he saw the Son of God not seated. This time he was standing. And you know that is now a major thing. Standing to receive a saint who's coming. Because this guy was just anointed to serve tables. And he was brought in because some women complained. And these women complained after Ananias had died. Ananias had seen people bringing in food and separating this. And it was because the Holy Spirit had come upon them. And who had spoken to these people? Peter. And where were they? In the upper room. And you see how it transcends until Paul comes into the picture. If it were not for Stephen, you don't know if Paul would have been in this place. But God finds a way of introducing Paul to his work. Hallelujah. Amen. And that's what I call the grace of God. There's a way in which God manipulates things to bring his favor upon you even when you don't deserve it. So Paul appears, and this is now chapter number 6. Chapter number 7, this guy is stoned. In chapter number 8, you see now miracles coming through these guys who are going to preach. You see somebody preaching up to a certain guy who thought he was very wise. You know, this sorcerer. He comes and he sees things happening and he says, by the way, I can give you something to know. But I want you to see how these things operate even in the house of God. He sees that by the laying hands, you know, after somebody, Philip had preached to this guy, and he called the people from Jerusalem and they laid hands on these people. And he saw that upon the laying hands of people received the Holy Ghost. He said, I also want this gift. And he said, I can give you something. Let me give you something so that even you give me this power. And he thought that the gift of God can be purchased with money. Please remember the grace of God. You cannot get this. There are some people who are anointed and they are pure people who never went to school. And they are so anointed, they are laying hands on people and they are receiving the Holy Spirit. What do we explain? How do we explain an unlearned person laying hands on somebody and receiving the Holy Ghost, and yet another one who has thought that he's such a wise man and has money cannot do it? The grace of God. I don't know if you're seeing where I'm going. So this happens in chapter number 8. Chapter number 9, now we see this guy going out there breathing fire. And when he goes out there, a light hits him and he falls down. And immediately he says, who are you, Lord? Because you know this cannot be any other person. He's hit, he goes down there. And the Bible says, I love King James, as I said. He says, when he opened his eyes, he saw nothing. That is, he opened his eyes and he saw nothing because he was blind at that time. He was told, wake up from here. There's somebody who's coming to show you what to do. And he was told, you cannot hit the wall with your hands and not feel the pain. Where is it began in a moment? There is a grace of God that followed him, even though he was going in a wrong direction. God's grace followed him because of the pure heart this guy had. He was zealous for the things of God and he thought he was doing the right thing. That is chapter number 9. Then we go to 10, it brings you back to Peter. Peter on top of the roof, feeling like eating, and he has not eaten, and God drops this thing and tells him, by the way, you know, when you're fasting, and these things can come, and God knows how to get you with what you're thinking. You know, God gets you to be not even thinking. Because he says when he was thinking about food, now God brings this thing, he tells him, eat this thing. And he says, Apartments, we are equalizing to my Bible. You know? And he's told, there are some people I'm sending to you. There are some people who are not Jews. And they were being brought in here. And God himself was orchestrating a miracle through Peter. Remember the first Peter in chapter number 1. This is the same Peter who has come out and preached this thing. The same Peter comes and now is on top of this roof and he sees this thing. He's not asleep. He's actually seeing it as if he's asleep. Because he's seeing it in the spirit. Then he's told, there are some people I'm sending to you. Go with them without doubting. But before that, God had sent these guys who have a heart for God, and yet they are Gentiles. And they come to this very place by the direction of God. By what? By the grace of God. That grace that manifested to them was drawing them. And it's not because they were Jews. It was because of what was in their hearts. And as they saw it coming, thank you very much. As they saw it coming, they understood what God was doing, and they were told to go with them. And to show that the grace of God can be multiplied to any other kind of person, it doesn't matter your background, when Peter was still speaking to them, the Holy Spirit fell upon them. You know, the other ones, they had to lay hands on them, but this one, when he was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon them. And when he fell upon them, then they realized there's something special here. Then they say, now what can stop us from baptizing them? Because they had believed that you baptize them, then they will receive the Holy Spirit. Or by that baptism is where now they show that they have accepted the Lord. But here the Lord pours his spirit upon them even before they baptize. And that brings up, it's the opposite of what happened in chapter number 8, where you see Philip going, and when he's in certain place, he ties himself and he's told, go near that eunuch. And when he walks next to the eunuch, he asks him, what are you reading? He doesn't understand what he's reading. And by the time he convinces him about the things of the Lord, and this guy receives the Lord, the guy is so excited now, he wants to receive the things of God, then he says, actually, there's water here. You can baptize me. See that what happens. Is me baptized after accepting this. Now, these guys have come, the Holy Spirit has come upon them even before their what? Their baptism. By the what? The grace of God. So that he brings you to a point of recognizing that it's not by your works. It's not where you come from. It's not your genealogy. It's not your cadre. Paul was a top, learned under the feet of Gamaliel, who was a professor of law in those days. He's somebody who was so learned. Yet, Peter was also in the same grace. Hallelujah. Amen. We see the same grace multiplied to them. And I want you to understand that when we deal with the grace of God, we are dealing with something that is not merited. We are dealing with something that you cannot fight. You are dealing with something that you cannot earn. The only problem we have, and I wish we had enough time, is that people mistake the grace of God as license for sin. Because now people want to understand that it's by grace. And that's why when you go to the book, the story that Calvin comes out with those five graces of God, he talks about those particular things which I don't want to get into right now, but he brings out an understanding that the first one is that every man is depraved. Every man has fallen. We are all sinners. We cannot achieve anything without God. And we need God to bring us to that point. Listen, we must understand that that's the first place that we need the grace of God. We start from that point. But then we get to a point where we get people who are living their lives carelessly. And there's this doctrine that people believe. And for me, I think it's something that is mistaken. That they believe that since you are born again, and the Lord has poured his blood upon you, and you are saved, everything is okay. You can live with the Lord, you can do all manner of things, so long as that blood was shed for you, it's all okay. And for me, I have a small theological problem with that. And you can argue all your things about what Calvin talks about, and the other people support him, Spurgeon and all the others, and Luther and all the others, but there is a point in which your interpretation must be correct. Because listen, the same Paul we are talking about comes at one point and says this, listen, that I will not, after speaking this word, I become a castaway. Have you ever heard that thing from Paul? What does it mean? It means that I can actually have all this work, then at the end of it, I become what? A castaway. The same Paul tells us to work out your salvation with what? Fear and what? Trembling. He knows what he's talking about. You read the Bible and say, I'm praying that your names will not be blotted from the book of life. Blotting means that it was there, but it has been blotted out. I do not know your theology, but I will be careful that I do not run into sin with the license that since I am born again, everything is okay. It doesn't happen like that. And someone says, you know, I can do that. It's just by the grace. People are not giving tithe because we are now living under grace. You know, that was under the law. Everything is under the law. Now I'm under grace. And under grace, listen, when you go back and read scripture and shows you things about giving, give and it shall be given to you, good measure, shaken together, pressed down, running over. How does it start? Give, isn't it? And it shall be. So you can't just operate your life carelessly because you are under grace. People are sinning. You find Christians living a very careless life. Look at what happened in Romans 1, and that's where the story began, where somebody comes in and starts a story and does the things of their life the way they want. And the Bible says, God gave them up to their desires. Why? Because they did not want to retain the knowledge of God and they did not glorify Him. He gave, and the next thing says, women started lusting for women, doing things unnatural. And men followed after, burned with lust after other men. Homosexuality and lesbianism is a prelude of people who have refused to honor the Lord. And that's why God turned them over. Turning over means that you are being given over to something. You are here, but I'm turning you over to your lust. And that's why we argue. Then Paul says, does it mean then that because when sin increases and grace abounds, do we then continue sinning so that grace can increase? That's one of the arguments you read through the book of Romans. Because guys have come to a level and says, we are now living under grace. Stop judging us. I got a new thing, by the way. If people say you are judging them, please use another expression. Tell them that I'm fruit inspecting. Because you shall know them by their fruits. So I want to see if your fruit is correct. People want to live the way they want to live. They do not want to live right. And they want to cover themselves under the grace of God. I have explained to you what the grace of God is. It is true. We cannot achieve. And God has His own ways of revealing His truth to us. God is sovereign. And there are things that we cannot go back to God and say, why did you decide to save me this way? Why did you decide that I would be born here? God is sovereign, and He does. And the Bible says He places people where He wants. And He does that for His own glory. You cannot explain many of these things, but you need to understand that God is a just God. And I believe that God will not punish you if He didn't give you the ability to make choices. I will not punish you for not having chosen, and I did not give you the ability to make a choice. If you read the Bible, it says God is a just God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We love the scripture that says, you know, for God so loved the world that He gave. What's the next one? That whosoever, and so whosoever, I think it's just a whosoever. It brings in every soever. Isn't it? It does not specify which soever. It just brings every which soever. Which means that God. And you go to Titus, it says, the grace of God has appeared to all men, teaching them to say no to ungodliness. It has appeared to all men. So it's a grace that has appeared to all men, but it is you now, you have been taught. You see, when in Genesis the Bible says that sin is near you, and you must conquer it. It is you who makes the choice. You have something in you. So don't operate under the guise that the grace of God covers. And these are the doctrinal. If you are a student of, I didn't want to get into them, because some of these leave you wondering then what happens. But I want you to understand from scripture. Understand scripture more than commentaries from people. Read the word of God. Understand it. Let God minister to you and show you these things. And open up your heart and understand these things. When Jesus was speaking, I'm just finishing up, that's my last minute. When Jesus was speaking to in the book of Revelation, he brought up a number of things. And he said, I see the good things you have done. You do not sit with these guys, Nicolaitans, whom I also do not love. Then he tells them, but this one thing I have against you. And he tells them, please change from this. If you don't, I will. Are we together? Are you seeing where I'm going? If you do not do this, then I will do. If you don't, I'll remove your life. If you don't, I'll spew out. There is something that is intended if you do not do something. And they are being cautioned. So you cannot take comfort in the fact that I am already here, everything is okay. If Jesus already given a warning that I will do this if someone doesn't change, I pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to us and understand the grace of God and understand it well. Because when you abuse the grace of God, this doctrine of grace, yes, brings in a lot of liberty where we understand that it is sisi ni wanyonge, it is God who has to do for us. But when Peter was writing, he says, I'm writing to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God dwells in you. He tells them again, I'm writing to you, young men, because you are overcome the evil one. There is something you must do. So there is a step you must take. So it's not just a grace of God that covers you and leave it out. It's something that you must work towards. Remember, work your salvation with fear and trembling. The Lord asks, if I came back, will I find faith? There are things that you must prompt your mind. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And you find when you're being asked in Hebrews that somebody who has walked and has received this salvation and comes back and walks upon the blood of Jesus. You know, it's like somebody who has now contempted the blood of Jesus and is now walking. And then you're told that that person is worse than if he had not gotten involved. There are things that you must really understand, brethren. Don't just go by what you hear and what you see. And especially, I love theology. I study a lot of it and I understand a lot of these things. But sometimes, theology can confuse people to the level where people can't make a right decision. I think sometimes you need to come back and ask the Holy Spirit, like the Bereans, go back to the Bible. Find out what the word says. Ask God to open up your eyes to understand these things. Then when you start seeing them, apply them. Brethren, let's be friends. That's why we are told, let's be holy. Because he who orders is holy. And when you go to the book of Revelation, he says that these people will not make it to the kingdom of God. They're liars. They're fearful. You know, they're depraved. They're immoral. There are people that are categorized. And you see, there are things that God is actually putting that they will not enter there. So it means that there is a certain duty of God. So you can't just be aimless. And God is not a liar. And he's not going to change. If you read the Bible properly, somebody says that God will have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah if he allows some of us to make it to heaven. Now that hits up the moment I was. I didn't expect that the man, I didn't get one more. God will have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah if he allows some of us into heaven. Because by hindsight, we know how Sodom and Gomorrah was. They did have a hindsight. God will have to apologize to the people who died in the flood during Noah's days if he allows some of us to make it to heaven. Why? It had never rained. So when they are told it's going to rain, they had a reason to doubt. But for you, you know it rained. Hallelujah. So we must be careful. And this is the gospel that I will preach. That we must, and this is safety for me. If the Lord will, at the end of it, bring everybody who will ever got born again into heaven, that is him who knows. But now, if he doesn't, and you happen to have relied on that thought, woe unto you. A friend of mine says, "Woe ye to you." Listen, I'd rather believe that I have to be righteous. And the righteousness is that attributed through the finished work of Jesus. Who has told me to be holy? Who has brought Paul and Paul has said, "Follow him the way I'm following him." And I move with him, and at the end of it, I make it to heaven. If you come the other way and you enter heaven, and I went this way, I have nothing to lose. But if I played around, then I happen to get there and realize that I'm not making it. I have everything to lose. So may the grace of God be real for you. But may you do that which is required of you. May God help you to understand that you must do your work. And may God help you to be holy. Those who are living sinful lives, please repent. Because that's a message that John the Baptist came to preach. He could not be preaching repentance if there's no need to repent. He preached it because people needed to repent. Remember Jonah. When Jonah was going into Samaki Express, it was because he had refused to go where he was sent. He was supposed to go and speak to people, and these people were going to be destroyed by the Lord if they did not change. And he refused. God had to give these people a chance. When he arrived there, he spoke, they repented, God forgave them. There's a process. It was very easy for God now to decide, "I've forgiven you." Could he say it? He could have said it. But he had to send somebody to speak to them, and they had a choice of repentance. May God help us. We can have all theological arguments, but at the end of it, it's your life. And it is how you live it before the Lord. May God really help us. May all of us understand the grace of God, and may that grace of God abound for you. And those who are going through a difficult time, just like Paul lifted his hand, and he talked to God 3 times and says, "God, remove this thing. Remove this thing, O Lord. Remove this thing." And God told him, "I'm not removing." And he had to be given an answer and told, "By the way, my grace is sufficient." There's an enablement that comes from the grace of God. If you're going through a difficult time, my dear, my brother, hold on, because God's grace is sufficient for you. Father God, I thank you. I bless you that you are God. I honor you that you understand what we go through. I'm asking in the name of Jesus. Even having seen what has been talked about the reformists and all the Calvinisms and all the manner of things and predestinations and all those manner of things that have been preached, Lord, at the end of it, we come back to your word. And we ask that you open up our eyes to understand what we need to do. Just like Ezekiel would come and tell the Israelites what they needed to do at that time, help us to know the word of God and follow it up. I'm praying, God, for any person here who may have strayed, believing that the grace of God covers them even into sin. Father, may that grace and that Holy Spirit convict their hearts and turn them into repentance. Father, may each one of us here be assured of salvation. Have a testimony and have a knowledge, O God, of you. And be convicted that if anything happened to them today, they will make it to heaven. I bless you and I honor you. Father, may this open up their understanding and may this grow even to bring them to another realm of understanding the grace of God. And may this grace that is within us continue to grow in them. I want to make a very quick prayer. No time is gone. If you're not born again and with all eyes closed and heads bowed, this is a good opportunity for you to know the grace of God. It is that hand of faith that you have that will meet the mercy of God and manifest this grace of God. So if you're there, you're not born again, but you're saying this is a day. You know that sometimes God has prompted you, even if I didn't speak today, you would just have gotten born again. God has dealt with your heart. That's the grace of God pushing you into salvation. What some people call irresistible grace of God. So I want you to lift your hand wherever you are. You want to receive the Lord Jesus. I'll make the prayer for you. from where I am here. Just lift it right up. Don't put it down. Yes, I've seen that hand. Is there another person? You want to receive the Lord? You want to get born again? I see another hand behind there. God bless you. Is there another person? I want to pray. Is there somebody else who wants this grace of God? I see that hand. I see the other one. God bless you. I see that hand, my sister. God bless you. I see those hands that have gone up. I want to give you another opportunity. Is there any other person who wants to join this one before I make the prayer? I see that hand behind there. God bless you. So I want to make a prayer. I see that other hand that has gone up. Would you want to? I see these hands in front here. I want to make this prayer. Don't get ashamed. Would you just stand and I make this prayer for you? Those who have lifted their hands. All other heads are bowed and all our eyes are closed. Just stand. Stand, my sister. Let's just stand, my brother. Stand. Just, I want to make the prayer for you as you're standing. I thank you, Jesus. So make this prayer with me from where you are. Just speak it out to God. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. I know I am a sinner. I repent of my sins. I ask you, O God, to come into my heart. Write my name in the book of life. I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ, you are Lord. I refuse you, Satan, with all your works. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In Jesus' name. Let me make a prayer for you. Father, I thank you for these dear ones who have received you. Father God, when they stand before you like this, we know in heaven there's joy. And I'm asking God that you give them courage. Let that grace of God that has manifested to them today and the faith that has stand up their hearts towards you. I'm praying in the name of Jesus that it will work out, my Father, to remove them from things that they were in before. Any things that tied them, any relationships, any rituals, any curses, anything that may have held them. Lord, we release them from it in Jesus' name. And we ask, Lord, that you give them confidence. I'm asking Jehovah that even as they are, Jehovah King of Glory, when they will be leaving this place, Father God, they will stand strong and they will identify with the Christians. They will identify with those who know you. They will grow. Father, I pray for supernatural growth upon them. I'm praying that some of them, being first years or whatever year they are, by the time they are leaving this university, Father, they will be people who have worked things for your honor and your glory. I pray for the rest. I'm praying for those who may be sick. I'm praying for those who may have backslidden. I'm praying for somebody here, my Father, who is saying in their heart that they want to come back to the Lord. They were strong in the Lord, but something happened. And yet they are crying out to the Lord. Lord, I pray that you reach out to this person. We bless you and we honor you. Father, may your grace abound for us. Help us to understand more things. And over this weekend, open up our understanding of what sin is. Help us to understand the dimensions of God. And Father, at the end of it, let it be a time that we can celebrate. We bless you and we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm hoping that from today, when you will be asked to share the grace, you will know what you're sharing. Amen. Blessings.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Are we blessed?
Yes.
Yes, thank you so much, servant of God. Yes, for just enlightening us about grace. Yes, what I've gotten tonight, grace is unmerited favor from God. It's not all about our works, and we must accept the grace for it to work in us. But I just feel it. Yes, so I believe that as we continue to journey in this weekend of scripture engagement. With the grace of the Lord will abound in us. God bless us if you will. Yes, and it will be the desire of each one of us not to misuse the grace of God. Praise the Lord. Yes, let's not live in sin and say grace is sufficient. God bless us if you will. Yes, so thank you so much for that wonderful word. Yes, thank you so much, Focus, for just being this scripture engagement. And I believe by the end of this weekend, we'll have moved a step. But I just feel it. Yes, that is just the beginning. How many of us are planning to miss tomorrow by the show of hands? How many are planning to miss? How many are promising to be there? Yes, I encourage us to keep time tomorrow. The session will begin at 8. At 8. Where's the venue? Yes, we are the host, so we are expected to be there. Let the visitors not come and find us missing. Yes, let's keep time for the same and be expectant. But here's just a few ways. I also encourage us to carry notebooks and pens. Let's not trust our memories. But here's just a few ways. Yes, najua wenye wajabeba kalamu, pengine hata umesahau. Mana ya grace. So I encourage us tomorrow to carry notebooks and pens so that you can just write something down, and that will help you to remember what we'll be learning in the course of the weekend. Yes, you can be upstanding. Yes, I would like to welcome our regional coordinator, Mr. Everton Kataka, who will say hi to us and also conclude the meeting with a word of prayer.
Yeah, praise the Lord. Amen. Yeah, we are looking forward to our fruitful weekend. Thank you so much, Dr. Humphrey, for making it and speaking to us. We are so much grateful to you. Yeah, so we pray. We thank you, Father. We ask that you give us a fruitful night. We pray that God, you be with us, even as we head to our various hostels and places to rest. We ask that God, you will indeed protect each and every one of us. And so, Father, we give you all the glory, and all the honor for this day. So we pray this, we give you and trust you in your name. Amen. Amen. Now may the grace of